This is the share of income that each income bracket will pay in sales and excise tax as a share of the family income. So the first thing you'll notice about this chart is that it's much more unevenly distributed here. So as a share of lower income folks is much higher than folks at the top. So does anybody, you know, have any good guesses as to why that might be?
Where people spend every cent they have to live.
We tax on food.
Tax on food. Anyone else?
Okay.
Some math as well. So generally our tax on sales affects things that everybody buys,
yep.
But because the, you know, folks who earn more, they have greater income, it's never going to be as large a part of what they make. Excise taxes is a really interesting one. So that just means that taxes are levied on the volume of something you purchase. So you can think about, you know, gasoline or cigarettes or, you know, gallons of milk. And that kind of volume is based on that. So then that tends to bear, that incidence of tax has more impact at folks who earn less, because there's kind of an upper bound on how much of that we would buy. So somebody who's very wealthy would buy the same amount, more or less, of those things than somebody who earns much less. We call a distribution like this something that a tax that's regressive. So it takes more share of income from folks at the bottom end of the income spectrum and tends to make income, you know, differences much worse than they were before. So the next type of tax I'll tell you about is the distribution of the personal income tax. So this sort of has the opposite structure. You can see that folks at the top end of the spectrum pay more, and it gets even into the negative numbers, which means that folks who are filing receive certain non-refundable tax credits and so forth that increase their income. Does anybody have a good guess as to why the distribution here is the way it is?
Well, the lowest income people would get the tax credits for child care and grocery credit and the rest of it.
Yes, that's part of it. In Idaho, we have what's called a graduated tax system as well. So, you know, if you've ever looked at the tables, you know, that help you to file your taxes, you'll see that there's different rates levied on certain amounts of income. So, you know, you'll start at a small rate, I think around 1% or so for the first X amount. And then, you know, gradually as you earn more above that income, that will be taxed more. So that's what contributes to the distribution of the sales tax being the way it is. And
what,
the last.
What is the top bracket for income in Idaho?
Well, so this is taxable income. So first you'll take your deductions that, you know, folks have a standard deduction and different related ones. So the after-tax income for the top rate starts, I think, at around $10,000 of taxable income. Okay, and the third type of tax is our sort of our local, our main local one, is a property tax. As you know, in Idaho, most localities don't have authority to levy an additional sales tax or anything, so this is what we consider to be primarily our central local tax. And this one it behaves much differently. It's a little bit regressive, but not strongly so. The effect of it is not as great. But it is interesting to see that it still has slightly regressive effects. And that's important to know, I think, later on when we will discuss what property tax is often used to fund, which will be public schools. All right, so this is the combined effects of all of our different forms of taxation and how they fall on different households based on what they earn. So the overall effect of our tax structure is that it kind of evens out a little bit, but not completely, right? You can see that there's certain differences in how it operates. And then finally, uh, the combined effect, taking into account all of the federal impact as well, it sort of mitigates things for folks in the middle, but doesn't have a strong impact, you know, at the lower end of the income spectrum. So why is all of this even important? You know, taxes, you know, should be shared equally. I think we can sort of all intuitively grasp that that's a fairness principle. But when our tax structure is designed in a way that doesn't make income differences worse, so in other words, mitigates income inequality, we are promoting what would be, you know, continued participation by everybody in our economic and social life. So, you know, if we're not making it harder for folks to earn money at different ends of the, at different places in the income, then they're able to go out and buy goods and services. They're able to go and, you know, purchase things and not have it made harder on them. So the principle of having a progressive income system, which is one that doesn't make income inequality worse, allows us to enhance the economy as well. So, and you'll see that primarily from the charts that it's the role of the income tax that provides that. You know, the other strength of the income tax is that it keeps, since we're able to deduct them from our federal taxes as well, it helps to keep dollars in Idaho. And the income tax is generally more stable than the sales tax. So, you know, you'll see the sales tax fluctuate. You'll see both fluctuate, you know, as we go, you know, just kind of go through the business cycle of boom and our economy is growing and then it contracts, you know, like we have a recession every about 8 or 10 years. The income tax will be relatively more stable than the sales, which is also still pretty stable, but again, lots of goods and goods are inelastic, meaning that you know, it you can't sort of choose to buy less because they're necessities. I feel like I was going to say one final thing about the income tax, but maybe it'll come to me later. All right. I would like to discuss sort of recent tax policy changes that have occurred in Idaho, maybe over the past decade or so.
It'll come back.
Oh, okay. Great.
Oh, yeah. It might come out a couple weeks ago that it does that.
Well, that is very charming. of course, a big shift occurred in 2006 when sort of because the policy agenda included lots of discussion about how much pressure folks were feeling from the property tax. The discussion was, you know, how do we alleviate that, but still fund, you know, the things that we have decided as a state we're going to fund. Well, we're going to eliminate a provision that took in revenue and sort of distributed it to schools throughout the state in a way that was equitable, and instead add in a penny or percentage point on the sales tax in order to replace that lost revenue. So, and the switch at that time was the equivalent amount of money, somewhere around the $250 million range, by eliminating one tax and then adding a percentage point to the sales tax. Does that make sense? I see sort of a couple questions. Okay. Great, so,